Hello everyone, my name is Pixlriffs and welcome back to the Minecraft Survival Guide. I hope you guys are having a good day. Today I'm starting off over here at the flowers and plants exhibit that I built in the last episode, and as you can see, I have been going to town a little bit on the decor around here. We ended the last episode with not much in the way of cave ceiling in this cave diorama that I decided to present all of the plants in, and now we have one. I also decided, once we closed the cave roof in, that torches on the ground was not really something I wanted. I'm fine having the occasional torch on the walls here and there. We might be able to dress up some of those a little bit later, maybe put item frames and like little holsters for them or something like that. But for now, I decided to go with lanterns. And to be honest, this gave a really nice feel to walking around this space because it almost feels like the lanterns are the thing you should follow to stay on the path. They're all hanging basically directly over the area where I want the player to be walking. We've even got one that kind of comes down dead center of this little crossroads section here where it's kind of going towards all of the saplings and stuff. So I thought that worked out pretty well. I'm going to be altering a few of the torches around here that lead up towards the second part of this room, which remains unfinished for now because I'll be honest, I'm not entirely sure what I'm going to do with this part yet, but it is going to lead through the gallery walkway, through the dirt and grass exhibit, over into the main hall over there. So there's probably going to be some sort of extra bit up here that you can just kind of walk around. Maybe something about the dyes that the flowers make, or maybe a couple of interactive exhibits, because this one isn't really all that interactive. You don't get a chance to replant the sweet berry bushes or bone meal the 2-block-high flowers or something like that. It could maybe be an extension of what we have down here, or it could be a completely different exhibit. Haven't really decided yet. I am more keen on moving on into this room, because this room here, as you can tell from the grey of the surrounding concrete powder where I've laid out the footprint for the room, is going to be all about stone. And we're going to cover a couple of different things here. We're going to have the natural stone that you'll find as part of the environment, and then crafted blocks, blocks that only really show up when a player starts to interact with them, and the things that don't show up all that naturally, like cobblestone, for example. It's funny because when I was thinking through all of the stuff I want to do in this room, cobblestone occurred to me as one of those materials that is actually only really player made, which is kind of strange because yes, you can have it occurring naturally occasionally in things like mob spawner rooms, or if water happens to hit lava naturally while the two of them are just flowing around. But yeah, I was thinking about natural world generation stuff and putting that first as you go from the natural world part of the exhibit, from the trees and grass and dirt and everything through flowers into stone, I thought, well, cobblestone isn't necessarily going to have to be front and center in that. Instead, we're going to be looking at things like natural stone. You're looking at things like andesite, diorite, and granite, maybe even a little bit of gravel. I'm thinking we're probably going to put gravel in the same place here because we're thinking more about how the world around us generates on, you know, world spawn, basically. And maybe some ores might dip in here and there, but I think ores are really going to start appearing in the next room as we move into the progression of tools and things like that. And as we move around, ignore the trees right now, I'm just kind of growing those to farm them. And then over here, when we get to the Diamond Age stuff, going from there into the Nether is the idea. So from what we've got right here, I can safely say that we've got enough to do what I want in terms of placing the stone around. And I think as a little fun project, we're going to do something kind of similar to what we did with the lush cave underneath the flowers and plants exhibit. And we are going to try and make a facsimile of a dripstone cave. Basically, whatever imitation we can do in 1.16, I want to try and imitate a dripstone cave underneath this exhibit. Once again, to give you an idea about cave generation and maybe see some of the blocks in a more natural setting, because the setting up here, because this is a museum and we're kind of putting things out to be studied, is going to seem a little bit more artificial. All right, so here's what I'm thinking for the floor of this. It's not super special or anything. It's just a spruce log border with a bit of trim in polished andesite, and then the center is all going to be spruce planks. You can hear a few zombie noises, I think, from the areas that I've covered over and stuff is still spawning because there's just one layer of grass between me and the natural landscape. But even then, what we're going to do here is actually going to be a little bit more special than all of the floor that that we've laid down here already, I think we're going to do something kind of fun with the presentation of this stone. Because what I want to do is not just have individual blocks of stone. I feel like that's not representative enough of stone in its natural environment. Not to mention, I guess, we've just had them walk through a room that is completely covered in stone, and then you just have, like, one lump of stone with a, you know, a lectern next to it that says stone. Not really going to cut it, right? So what I'm thinking we do, the reason I have all of this soul sand in my inventory, is we are going to make a bunch of soul campfires. They could be regular campfires, but I just have a load of soul sand right now, and I kind of want to do something kind of fun with these. So hear me out here while I get a few more things prepped, because we are going to need more campfires than that. We're going to need a lot of campfires, actually. There we go, got about a stack and a half of campfires. What I want to do is arrange these in a large square like this. We're probably not going to have all the way. Let's see what we've got. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I think probably a 7x7 square, just the outside like this. And the reason for this will become apparent in a second, because what we are going to do is we're going to get a shovel and basically turn off all the campfires. Put out all the campfires around here, leaving what looks like a kind of wooden pallet. I was thinking a bit about how exactly folks in this museum were supposed to be moving stuff around, and I figured with something as heavy as stone, they would want it on like a forklift or something like that. You know, obviously we're not going to build an actual forklift for this place, but I think it makes a lot of sense to have stuff on these kind of wooden pallets. And if you just surround the blocks with campfires, they're all facing in the same direction because of the way they would kind of interlock like this. If we put some of this material in the middle here and then step back and take a look at this from the outside, it actually kind of looks like that's just slabs of material on top of the campfires already. Obviously, if we put something on top of the campfires, it's going to hover over it by about half a block, right? So what I was thinking we could do is build up this kind of like mound of stone as though it's just like a massive chunk of rock that's like been hewn out of the rock nearby, out of a cave somewhere nearby. And we just kind of have it taper up to a point like so, almost kind of practice here for the stalagmites and stalactites we're going to be building in our little dripstone cave simulation. But I think something like that actually looks quite nice as a way of presenting the stone in this exhibit. And what I think we can also do to complete the illusion of this resting on a pallet here is put a bunch of stone slabs on top of this, because then what that will do is give the illusion that the half block we've cut off at the bottom with the slabs is actually laid on top of it, and from a distance, without looking at the hitbox indicator there, it actually looks like a full block of stone resting on top of these pallets. You can kind of ignore the fact that there is a little bit of stone texture coming through there in the middle, or maybe even think that the pallet is just sagging under the weight of all of this stone, right? So we're going to make sure every single piece of stone here has a slab on top of it, and that is going to have the added benefit of also spawn-proofing it for us, so we don't need to worry too much about light levels. So giving it a nice two block border on all sides, and I think maybe we still need to add a slab onto the top. No, we've actually covered that as well. I wasn't quite sure if I had done that or not. That is all looking pretty great. That's our stone exhibit right there. And stone just in its raw form like this kind of makes sense for it to just be standing around out here. And I think what we're going to do is with a few more campfires around the outside here. Once again, we'll leave a two-block gap between each of these. We're just going to do a few smaller pallets for the other stone types, because I feel like what we're doing here is representing the composition of what you can find underground, and it doesn't quite make sense to put stone on an even footing as diorite, granite, and andesite, because you don't see as much of those around the world as you're digging. You mostly see stone everywhere, and so it makes more sense to have a smaller pallet of andesite and the other materials. Likewise, gravel only occurs in little pockets. We'll probably only use a small amount of it, and that means we can also space this room out a little bit more and not have the entire thing taken up by a large pallet like this. But I like that idea. I think it's come together pretty well, just in the overall look of that kind of sells it, really. I actually moved that around a little bit. I gave us three blocks in between each one, because that also spaced it out evenly to give us two blocks gap at the back here as well. And it just kind of made a little bit more sense to have a little bit more space to walk between these, as though you're kind of walking side by side with somebody. It feels like you can fit two people down there, right? So I think, yeah, we'll do a few more of these around the room. I don't see us really straying outside of naturally formed stone, although maybe on the opposite side here, we could do maybe a couple of pieces of crafted stuff. Maybe just show what you can build out of stone without converting it into something like stone brick, because of course we have stone slabs and stone stairs that aren't converted into stone brick stairs or anything like that. I don't think we can have stone walls, but you can of course have andesite walls, granite walls, and so forth. So there's a couple of things we can do with the natural stone that means that the space it takes up here will be offset by how few other things we can make with it in its raw form before we start converting it. And I think the conversion into crafting stuff is going to take place outside of this inner ring of stuff. I think it's probably going to be out here, or out here when we get into some of the the stuff that you can craft, like stone bricks and all of the variants of stuff that move on from there. So I suppose the next question is, where are we going to put our little model Dripstone Cave? What do we have? Wait a second. Is there some redstone ore here? What's going on? Aha! I've already built it via the medium of a secret entrance. We now have access to a Dripstone Cave simulation, kind of similar to the Lush Cave simulation that we built under the flowers and plants exhibit. And I've got to be honest, I'm digging it. I think it looks pretty good for what we've already got in the game. And I know you're probably wondering, hey, wait a minute, Pix, isn't the Dripstone Cave the point of this video? What's with the bamboozle? Why have you done this entire thing off camera? Well, friends, actually, I haven't. I did record the entire process. I just thought I would pull the rug out from under you, kind of literally there with the redstone entrance. But yes, I've got the entire process of building this recorded as a time lapse, and we're going to go through a little bit of the decision-making process together. So let's rewind a couple of hours. I'm going to show you the process of building this Dripstone Cave, as well as the process for making the secret door that let us down here. So naturally, we're going to want to build our Dripstone Cave underneath the floor here, and with that little clip I just showed you, we can sneak a redstone ore into that as our opening mechanism for the floor here to let us down into the Dripstone Cave. But I think we're going to encounter a couple of problems along the way, the first of which is, how on earth are we going to get around all of the mobs that are down here? Because if I break the floor and come down here, I'm already hearing quite a lot of mobs in the shadows, and I imagine a few more will spawn. So the first thing I'm going to do is probably just light up this area, and we'll probably end up making the roof of the Dripstone Cave relatively close to the surface anyway. And oh, good lord. What? I think I know what's happened here, and this is actually incredible. So there must be a chicken somewhere. There must be a chicken somewhere that has just been laying eggs. It's probably even still down there with the drowned, but the zombies have been picking up the eggs, and their random pathfinding has led them to walk into a pool of water, and they've just stayed there and all converted into drowned. And this is great. Look at these guys. Just all holding eggs inside of here. I think I saw one with an arrow or something, but that is wild. And of course, it's perfectly simple for us to just stand up here and attack all of them, because none of them will have got any tridents or anything, so they won't be able to hit me back right now. I think some of these drowned have even started to spawn reinforcement zombies, because I've been seeing a couple of them basically sneaking up on me where I am right now. But yes, unfortunately, none of these guys will help me out with my quest to get a bunch of Nautilus shells for more conduits. They are just going to drop everything that they would normally drop, including a little bit of gold, which, you know, I'm not going to turn down. But yeah, there's more than a stack of eggs there. That's absurd. Anyway, yes, that problem's solved, we return to the problem of sorting out the lighting down here. So with the lighting situation mostly sorted out for now, there's still going to be a couple of gaps here and there in the torchlight, but we're just going to have to deal with that for the moment. The next problem comes with exactly where I'm digging down into this cave, because I have a feeling that if I get a little bit further down inside of here, I'm going to reach the radius that we've dug out already for the archive, where all of my storage chests and stuff are. And so I have a feeling we're going to want to avoid that where possible, and I'm fairly certain that I have dug roughly towards the radius of the haste beacon, which if I end up getting a little bit further over this way, I think we'll be able to determine exactly where the edge of that is. Yeah, about here. So I think underneath about there is probably where I've already built stuff in the museum archive. And the last thing I want right now is for some of this water to come flooding into that room and wash away half of my redstone. So to counter that, I've come down here to the archive, and I'm just going to take the measurements of this wall here. So 2023 850 is more or less the area that we don't want to be digging down. 849. All right, cool. At least I know that, and that way I can try and avoid getting into the archive here or just building the cave around that. So that's actually about here, which is more or less the middle of the room. So the cave itself is actually going to overlap with the room behind it, which is fine. I don't foresee us actually putting anything in the basement area of the room behind for now. So I think what we're probably going to do is have it overlap, and as you go down into the cave, it's actually going to be kind of more behind you than in front of you. We're going to have a fairly impressive landscape to look at, but it's going to have to be in the opposite direction. That also means being outside of the radius of this beacon, so we're going to take that down and move it over there. And with our beacon now set up over here, directly above where I want to build the Dripstone Cave, and a little bit of digging on the horizon, I think this seems like the ideal opportunity for a time lapse. Hey folks, welcome back. I hope you enjoyed the time lapse, and I hope you enjoy my take on a Dripstone Cave. There are a couple of things that I'm trying to emulate with this beyond just the formation of a Dripstone Cave with all of those stalagmites and stalactites, which for the most part here are represented by granite blocks and granite walls, along with a few jungle fences, because they have that same kind of pinkish hue. Not exactly the same as granite, of course, but it's the closest in terms of wood and something that we can use to taper the structure of a stalagmite or stalactite down to a point. And of course, the actual stalagmites and stalactites we've seen so far in the screenshots that Mojang has provided are actually kind of like sugarcane or, you know, one of those other sort of plants, in that they have just a flat sprite cross section kind of thing, almost like regular grass does as well. Like, they almost seem like plants more than they do cave structures, because they're not block models. But I think that's probably a good thing, considering how many of them there are in these caves. They're also going to be able to fall directly on you, which of course these walls won't, and they do seem to have some sort of damaging property as well, so it'll be interesting to see how mechanics like that play out. But for now, with what we've got, I thought I did a reasonable job of this, and the Dripstone Caves we've seen in screenshots have been a lot more expansive, but apparently that is completely separate forms of cave generation. Basically, that is them messing around with the code that gives you more interesting looking caves, and honestly, I didn't really have the time or the patience to dig out a cavernous structure underneath here, because I also didn't want to take up as much room, because just in case we end up digging down into some stuff around here, and because the museum archive is just over there, I really wanted to give this a little bit of space, but not too much. The cool part about this, though, is it's taking advantage of some of the other stuff they were talking about when it comes to local water levels, and the fact that there are going to be these more expansive lakes down underground in the Caves and Cliffs update, where you'll be able to actually use a boat to get around. And in the screenshots and in the video footage, they showed people boating down these sort of waterfalls leading down into the structures of these caves. And you can actually get pretty deep from the surface. And the surface here is slightly higher than standard terrain. Like, I think up here I'm round about Y64 when I'm at the top of this little lake here. Yeah, this is Y65. So on the surface here, we're at about Y70, but you can see how much structure of this cave we're able to fit in. People are worried that they might end up moving around the terrain generation and raising the height of the land, and I honestly don't know if they need to, just because of how much we can really fit in underground here if you want a larger, expansive cave system. But my take on the Dripstone Cave is only really one part of this, because I have a feeling some of you might be interested in how I made a 2x2 redstone trapdoor in the floor there that dropped us down into the Dripstone Cave in the first place. And, well, that's all going to be part of this tutorial right now. So having grabbed a few redstone supplies, this process is actually going to be very, very simple. It doesn't require all that many redstone components, even. We need two observers per side, plus one to detect the redstone ore block back here. We have a bunch of sticky pistons. I think 13 is probably about enough. We have a block of redstone that's going to be activating and deactivating the circuit, but first of all, I think we'll probably do that with a lever just to show you guys how it works. And the stone blocks here are going to be where I put the redstone dust. Normally, I would use red concrete or something that stands out, but I kind of want it to blend in with the structure of the cave here. So the blocks are going to be appearing in this position here, so you'll never know that there was anything underneath them, but when they retract, they're going to end up underneath these blocks to either side. So behind each set of spruce planks that comes down here, we're going to want to have a pad of four sticky pistons like so, and we'll do the same on this side if I can place them. Yep, there we go, fantastic. Pulling the blocks back from around the sides a second, we're going to be placing two sticky pistons facing upwards. So the idea is that the pad of pistons back there fires first, pushing all four of these blocks outwards, and then these sticky pistons activate and push the blocks upwards, sealing off this area. Just for my own convenience right now, I'm going to remove all of the other cave-like blocks around here, just so they don't end up activating and causing a problem for the sticky pistons up here, and then we should be able to fit in the redstone wiring, which, like I said, is really not going to be that complicated. So on each side, we've taken away the blocks immediately behind these sticky pistons, and we're going to be placing observers facing in towards them like so. We're going to have another observer underneath here that's going to be activating the whole thing, but that's all the observers we should need, and we can cover this back up with planks now. And thanks to the fact that these observers are powering the pistons next to them, the pistons below those should power thanks to quasi-connectivity, so we don't need to worry about putting blocks there. What we do need to worry about is having a row of redstone dust along here, which is going to be a little bit difficult in this cramped space, but I think we will manage. When we put the redstone dust up here, the observers are going to be pushing some stuff around, but don't worry too much about that. We'll get that fixed later. For now, we want to make sure we have a row of redstone dust that comes down one block lower than that and surrounds the rest of the contraption. This is to make sure that we don't have any blocks powering these pistons when we don't want them to be. We're going to do the same here on the opposite side with four pieces of redstone dust running alongside here and then into a block that's going to activate the sticky pistons that push the blocks upwards into the floor again. And I think I'm probably going to have to take the floor away just so I can show you this in a little bit more detail, because right here, you can't really see all that much. I guess this is why everybody does their redstone tutorials in creative mode. But here we go. We get a decent overview of the circuit from up here. It's basically the same circuit mirrored so that you end up with this exact structure exactly the same but flipped on the opposite side. And what we have right here is a bunch of redstone dust coming around the back here, making sure that it is triggering these two observers, and the pistons underneath them should fire anyway. But the rest of this redstone wire comes down here and it meets this block, which is what's going to be powering these pistons in the center. And I can show you this just by attaching a lever to this block. It's not going to power this half of the circuit just yet, but if I activate this, there we go, it pushes into place. All of this stuff fires once thanks to the observer power, but then the block here is powered by the redstone dust, and so is the one on the opposite side, which allows these pistons to be extended permanently. And when they retract again, it all gets pulled back into place by the four pistons that are activated by the observers. Of course, the way to have this trigger both sides of the circuit is simply to add another redstone dust here next to our activation component, because once we activate that, all of the blocks get pushed up into place. Once we remove that, everything goes back to where it was and the player can fall through. Of course, what we're going to do is have the redstone dust on the opposite side, because then by tapping a redstone ore block inside of here, we can trigger an observer to push a redstone block into contact with this line of redstone dust, activating the entire circuit. And then when the redstone ore updates again, which it will do once the glowing effect has gone away, it will trigger the observer a second time, the whole thing closes up and you would never know it was there, potentially trapping the player inside the Dripstone Cave. But I'll probably just put a staircase somewhere in there that they can use to exit via another part of the museum. Thankfully, I had a couple of pieces of redstone ore in one of the chests, presumably from when I'd been digging down into the abandoned mineshaft and stronghold areas. So we have a piece of redstone ore that we can fit in somewhere here. And I'm going to have to be a little bit careful of the spacing here, because we don't want the redstone block to activate the circuit at any other time. Ideally, it just wants to be pushed into that space there to activate these wires, and that should activate the entire circuit nice and easily. Let's just pop one in now just to get the feel for it. Yep, okay, that works just fine. I ended up getting pushed up into place. That's great. And actually, this works out pretty well just with an ore block in the center, because all we should need to do is have a sticky piston there, an observer facing up into that block, and then replace that block with our redstone ore. Yes, there we go. Okay, and that doesn't seem to have activated any other components of the circuit, so that's looking great. All we should need to do is put the redstone ore in here, and there we go. I think it worked even though I fell through. Let me go up to the surface and check that for a second. Yep, it looks like everything is how it should be. So I'm just going to put the floor back into place, going to place the rest of these campfires to complete the illusion here. And there we go. Our first piece of redstone hidden in the museum. This is something I plan on doing throughout the museum, just to have little secret entrances and stuff hidden that lead you down to other places. So players might think, there's a sound of water flowing from somewhere. End up hitting that, and it drops them down into our Dripstone Cave. And I do kind of wish that we were able to build it facing in the opposite direction, so you could be dropped down and immediately see what you were supposed to be looking at. But there you go, the redstone ore glow has gone, and the mechanism has closed up again. So we just need to conceal this as part of the cave, and then I can go back and record the bit that you saw earlier where we actually activated this thing for the first time. Well, folks, I hope you've enjoyed this little look at building a Dripstone Cave and the stone exhibit that's up there on the surface as well. That's going to come together over the next few days. I expect I'll do some walls and stuff in there, and I'll bring you guys back in if there is anything worth sharing for the design aspect of that, but it's just going to be a little bit of building. And I think this Dripstone Cave turned out pretty well, although I'm still really excited to see how things look in the finished 1.17 Caves and Cliffs update. That's not coming until next summer though, so I kind of can't wait. I kind of want to get stuck into some of the cave design aspects in the meantime. But I hope you folks enjoyed it, and maybe it'll inspire you to build your own Dripstone Cave before we get access to the real thing. But that's going to be it for this episode of the Minecraft Survival Guide. I do hope you've enjoyed this episode. If you have, don't forget to leave a like on it for me. Subscribe if you want to see more, and I'll see you guys soon. Take care. Bye for now.